a rehab counselor for adults with lots of different disability issues. So basically, I'm not going to read the slides to you. So what do you need to do? Does anyone need that accommodation?
No.
So just my two favorite points to think of for independence and success is to make sure that you're a great self-advocate, or build your child up to be a great self-advocate no matter what age they are. If they just got diagnosed and they're 8 months old, start now. Get them talking, get them, you know, do all that stuff. And then just have confidence. And that can be hard for all of us, you know. Keep your, and a lot of these things are that way. So to my right, let's go in order, are Leslie and Mackenzie. And you all can read what they have up there about their favorite things to remember. And they are kind of in the process of going to school and doing that type of thing. You'll hear more about that. And then we have Claire, who is actually a sibling of two twins. She's a triplet. And two of the triplets, right?
Yep.
Have cerebral palsy as well. So, and that is what Claire says, and the sibling kind of point of view is her keys to success in life. Anything else? All right, our main goal is to provide tools to assist you for transitioning to adulthood. The most beneficial support for someone facing a challenge comes from those who have been there. So peer support. We're at different stages. So Morgan is doing college visits, still kind of, you know, reveling in the teen years and looking forward to the future. Claire and Mackenzie, they're kind of in the throes of school, and they'll tell you a little more about that through our talk. And I have been out of, like, I've been through college twice and survived it. So that's not a good resource. And then we offer several viewpoints. As you can see, we have a sibling viewpoint. We have the person's been there, done that, and now it's reflecting back, the old one. Then we have Mackenzie, who's, you know, making her way through it. And then we have Morgan, who, so that was what we told you about, how she's working through it and learning things now that are going to help her as she embarks on her college years. Alright. Any questions? No? So those are our goals for this session. Okay. Everybody says the word transition and everybody's like, because they say that like at the 7th or 8th grade IEP, and like people go, oh my gosh, transition, that it sounds horribly scary and what is that? Okay, basically transition is just change. You know, I looked it up, that's what the dictionary is. Although I did not use dictionary.com, my fault. But next time I will. But Merriam-Webster basically says it's a change. It's a change of something in life, okay? We've all done change, right? Anybody here still the same person they were even a year ago? Probably not. Some changes, good, bad, otherwise have happened, right? Even if it's just you got a year older. That was a change, okay? But we somehow get freaked out by this word transition because we think like that's something bigger than a change. It is, but it isn't. Okay. I do know these slides better than I look like I do, but making sure that they help people too. For children with cerebral palsy, because they have disability, transition should by law start happening at 16. Some people will tell you it should happen earlier than that, and you should advocate for that, because I do believe, as Morgan already stated, it should happen as early in your child. If they want to sit, if they can sit in an IEP at third grade and hear what people are talking about them, why would you want people talking about your child behind their back if they can at least sit and listen to it and have some kind of contribution to it? Okay, that's how I feel about it. Now, the law says at 16, BR or somebody should be in there starting to coordinate that transition to high school and post-secondary education or post-secondary choices. Because not everybody is going to go to college. Just like not everybody in this room might have gone to college. CPR not, right? Okay. And that kind of just says, it requires the child to take the reins while the parent can gain the confidence to let go. I bolded that for a reason. People are like, what? You don't have a kid, they'll need me forever. No, maybe a little bit, but not forever 24/7. It's not a thing. Okay? So just take over. Alright. Okay, we can move on to the next slide. Okay. Because I'm a social worker, I have to have evidence-based, yada, yada, yada. Now, I hated all the other charts because there were all these theories, and theories are boring. So I found this cute little example of what an individual's response to change is. Okay, again, we've all been through change. Nobody is shocked by this slide. But as we talk more and more about transition and how to break it down, or what skills you or your child or whoever you're helping with different disabilities, you may be able to identify yourself in some of these emojis. See, I'm cool, I use emojis. And or maybe as you get closer to this time of transition, you will start to say, oh yeah, right, now I'm in the depression time, right? And it's going to get better, or so Kelly Swan said back in the day when she gave some help. All right? And the most important thing here is denial does happen. And I see it a lot later in life than people should think. So I see adults that have CP, that the parents are still like, but what is he going to do if he lives on his own? What if this happens? What if that happens? You know what? Well, we can what if our child to the point where they don't have the confidence to do anything. Instead of saying what if, say why not? And give them the support to do it. Okay? So denial is a thing. Made sense. Engagement is a thing. Alright? That's part of getting your child involved in the process, getting yourself involved in the process. Don't just assume that your special ed teachers are made to know the best thing. Just like Morgan said, the doctors, they have wonderful degrees and I love them, most of them. But I don't take their word to be, you know, the holy grail or whatever they say. Because I know me the best, right? And your children or you, depending on where you are in this time of transition, will be those people as well. And especially if you go to a primary care physician, be sure that we know that those people don't always know different things about CP, okay? So we need to be engaged so that we can get on to the rest of it. Like, decision making, what college are we going to? You know, Morgan was encouraged to do several different things this summer so that she can make an informed choice. She may not go to either of those schools, but she knows what she likes and maybe what she doesn't like. And other people on the panel and the group here have had those experiences as well, and we'll get into those a little more in a second. Integration into that decision and your ability to handle it, okay? It's just kind of delving in, going to college visits, realizing what's going on, or going to the program that may help you with a work program after high school, okay? All of those things. And then you survive and sustain and you do great things and you're happy and it's got a graduation hat or it can have a construction hat. I don't know. Some people see me do construction. Sure, why not? And you sustain yourself through life and it's good. All right, and then, you know, that'll repeat itself, but we won't go over that. So, go for it. Sorry, thanks. Things to remember, fireworks. These are just little key points that I probably, and more than probably already made. Adolescence and independence is challenging for everyone. Whether you're sitting in a wheelchair, using a walker, have trouble speaking or whatever, CP gives you, okay? That makes bag that we all love to talk about. It is not extra, it is not the reason why your adolescent is having an attitude. That is not CP, that is your adolescent being an adolescent. Be glad that they grew up to be an adolescent because many of us were told we wouldn't make it beyond the NICU. Okay, and try to remember that as you roll your eyes and walk away from them because they're not listening. Okay, having CP forces you to think about things that other people may not have to think about. It just does. Okay, I would be a little misguided to say, oh, well, it's just like everybody else, don't worry about it. It's not. But don't let that paralyze you. Don't say, well, I get NTP. College is not a thing. They might fail. No. No, don't let it paralyze you, and don't let your child feel like they're paralyzed because of your fear or their fear. Okay? All right. There's not a right or wrong way to successfully transition. I can't, none of us up here, even the old lady or these youngsters, can give you like a checklist. Oh, you did it right, good, go ahead and go on your way, you're good. It's not a thing. I think Dr. Jamma said that as well. There is no, here's the prescription, it'll be fine. Everybody's different. And everybody has the right to make their own choices. And sometimes maybe they're not the best choices, but they made their own choices. Developmentally, adolescents are seeking autonomy. They want to be independent. Don't squash it because you're scared or they're scared. Okay? Try to encourage it. Yeah, you can go and do like my mom did and cry in a corner later and everything. And she'll tell you that when you're 30 that she did that. You're like, oh, well, I still turned out okay. It's fine. They're shaping their self-identity, okay? None of you may enjoy the boy bands or the, who is it? I'm going to age myself, Nick Jonas, I don't know. Anyway, Miley Cyrus, whatever. None of you may like those people, but if that's someone who gives your adolescent confidence or your young adult confidence, ask them why they like those people. They're not going to tell you because they don't have CP. They might tell you that, but it's very rare what I hear. They're like, oh, I like them because they don't have CP and they can walk. Like, we don't really stay in that space. We don't. We're like, okay, this is life. Like, I'm over it. I'm going to succeed, right? So, and that's based on my parents were very strong and, hey, no slice of it. No, oh, your life is so hard, I'll do your chores. It's like, no, you can clean the toilet. That's what you can reach. You know? You know, so, but it shaped my identity. I was like, okay, I'm not going to get a break. But I knew that from the world now. And going to college, I knew, you know, hey, I'm not going to get a break. I may get accommodation, but that doesn't mean that's an easy road and somebody's going to do your homework. That's not a thing. Okay? I'm going to say that a lot. That's a cool thing the kids are saying now, so just so you know. All right. What tools do we use? You aren't going to interrupt me if you want to jump in, right? Because you know, I told you, I talked fast. Okay. Change your thoughts from, I'm doing this for blank's future, if you're a parent or your own, well, you would talk to their person, that might be weird, to we are working together to ensure their plans are acceptable, these plans are acceptable to everyone. So I'm not talking about like, you get the community together and y'all talk about it. I'm talking about, you know, you're in the IEP. You're not attending that IEP for your adolescent's future. You're attending so that you know their best interest is, and what they want is being heard in that meeting. Okay? Now, it's good to have their voice there. You know, I don't care if they have to use an on-com device and nobody in that meeting wants to sit until they punch in all those letters and whatever. I don't care. You are in this meeting, and you are legally obligated to listen to the student, whatever way they communicate. So think about it that way, instead of like, well, but we're not sure if it's going to work. I don't want to hear their point of view. If you and your child have decided we want to give this a try, and if it doesn't work, and we learned it's not the best way to go, then we learn that. I don't want the principal and special ed teacher saying, well, it's not what we would describe for them. I don't care. Do what's best for your child, and do it as a team as much as you can. I realize you're working with an adolescent team. All right. Knowledge. And this is, I'm speaking to the young people in the room, too. I don't mean to be dogging on you all of a sudden. If you have a question, ask it. And keep asking it. This goes to self-advocacy. Until you receive an answer that makes sense. And that's what I'm talking about. Like that doctor blah, 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 that they talk about, like, spasticity, dystonia, you may not know what those words are. You may not know what like a 504 plan is, an IEP. Like, you're just maybe thrown into this world all of a sudden because, I don't know what, but you know, it's just new, jargon or whatever. And you, if you don't know the answer, ask it. There's no silly questions, you know? And encourage that of your student. if they don't know an answer and they're like, well, how many feels even if I ask that question? No, there's gonna be maybe two or three other people that have that question, and you may be the one brave enough to ask it, okay? That also builds their confidence for when they go to a doctor's appointment for the first time, and you, help us all, have to sit in the waiting room, and you're gonna let them go in by themselves because they gotta try it, they gotta get practice. Yes, this is so important, we repeated it three times. That's on purpose. It goes back to the two points above. Okay, nobody knows nobody knows your child better than your child and yourself. And if they think they do, you need to educate them. Okay?
I'm going to insert that right there.
Yes, please.
Okay. Kenzie and I were talking the other day about this, and sometimes you don't even know what advocacy means. Like, it can be defined in so many different ways, but she had an aide the last two, her junior and senior year, and she was a nice lady, but she was very strong-willed, and oftentimes they didn't see things the same way. So she was brought up to be respectful of adults and teachers especially, and so we had to really talk through and let her realize that she had to do what was best for her. I mean, nothing mean, if there were some little things, they weren't huge, but I feel like that was something that took me a while to catch on, to really work with her on, is that it's her life and it's her body, and that teacher's, that aide is there just to assist her, to be her hands and to be her, you know, not to her brain. And so anyway, just that kind of caught me a little bit off guard, so.
No, you're right. Now I put the lines, not all of them. Go to law school, everybody knows. Federal rights related to education, including post-secondary education. So there are laws that cover post-secondary education. The IDEA actually has parts to it that cover post-secondary education. Okay, that's where I got that quote about the 16-year age. It's like the bare minimum that they have to wait to start talking about transition. You should do it in kindergarten, in my opinion. All right. But also employment, transportation, all those things that will be affecting your access to different things. Okay, you may decide based on college visits, transportation in a, you know, for, you know, smaller school may not work for you. May not work for your student because you're going to be 5 hours away.
Yes.
Communication. People should directly communicate with the person with the disability. We could all talk on this for 5 hours. Could we not? Okay, raise your hands. Who has been to a restaurant and had a waiter or waitress say to your mother, father, brother, sister, significant other, boyfriend, what does she or he want to eat?
Yeah.
Yep. I see all of us are raising our hands. High school on through our 30s. This has happened. Okay, so but that's education. If you're in an IEP meeting and they're saying, well, Miss Champion, Miss So-and-so, I really feel like you're talking about Morgan, talk to Morgan. Ask Morgan what her opinion is. Ask Mackenzie what her opinion is. You know, we all can talk. There may be different ways. Even if your child can only do yes or no's reliably, you ask yes or no questions still, we get the answers we want, okay? Or they want you to get, okay? For our kids under 18, parents do have to legally make decisions. Legally, yes, you have to agree, but your child should be engaged in the process, is the point, okay? Because once they get over 18, they're going to have to be able to do those things and make those decisions, or at least communicate about them, okay? All right, education. We might have already talked a lot about this. Yeah, we talked about the student needs to be involved in college tours, their IEPs beforehand. Education will look different for everyone. So even on our panel, that was the case. And that's okay. There's no right or wrong way to do anything related to CP or anything related to life, okay? For anybody. And Claire has a very good example of this. Claire, what is your example of a difference in education?
Well, when my brothers and I were in sixth grade, we had finally decided to put Benjamin and I in a classroom together, and it just was going horribly. His aide wasn't doing everything he needed, and so then I would come try to help, and I would get punished by the teacher for it, and so he wasn't getting everything he needed. And so my mom decided in the middle of that year to pull us out and start homeschooling, and we were homeschooled all the way up until college, and it was the best decision we could have ever made, not just for Benjamin and Mason, but for me too. And then, so what I would say to that is if you do decide to do something differently, like homeschooling, you're still going to be able to get into college. We all got into college with scholarships, so it's totally fine and good and beautiful to do things differently.
We've talked about this. Education and transition plans are mandated by federal laws. And if somebody says we don't do that until they're 21, no. That's because they want to keep your child in whatever programming they're in until 21. If you want that, if your child wants that, great. But don't let anybody tell you, we don't do that till this time. They are mandated by federal law at 16 at the latest. And I would argue that, as I've already said 5,000 times. Okay, section 504 and the education of children with the IDEA. Both of those cover public education for children for students with disabilities. You probably have some idea of what some of your benefits have been for those. Accommodations, longer test taking time, okay, all those things. Large print ACTs or large computer screen ACTs or whatever they do.
Can I ask a question real fast?
Yes, sir. Please.
You say public education. What if your child's in private school? Yeah. Can you get them to allow for that longer testing time?
Depends.
And things like that.
So in Missouri, our private schools will contract out to different special school districts, special ed districts, and bring that person in to provide that help for that student or that accommodation. You need to advocate, because I've heard horrible stories with private education saying, you don't have to do that. And I honestly knew this question was going to come up and didn't read enough in the IDEA to see if that was actually mandated by that or if it's a case-by-case basis, because sometimes federal laws say, yes, it's case-by-case in different states. Does anyone else in the room actually know?
I work in special education,
Okay, cool. And
my understanding from the district I work for is the particular school district has to have a private school plan, and there are funds available from that. So, but you'd have to check with your district special education department.
So it sounds like you can advocate or you can ask questions about that.
My son in a private school, and they were very upfront with us and saying, please provide his 504 or his IEP, and we will let you know how much of that we can do.
Right.
And honestly, he's very mildly affected, and he had no accommodations even if he had a 504 plan.
Uh-huh.
And I have to say that they have been much more common sense and easier to work with than the public school administration we were trying to do. So for us, it's been great, but they were very upfront and saying, we don't have everything. But we'll let you know what we can do, and you can make a decision on whether or not it's right for you.
I will say it is not federally mandated.
Okay, thank you.
We're in Georgia. We're not in Texas, but it is not federally mandated. But in Georgia, they do offer a program where if you're pulling out of a school system, or if you've been in private school and you started in private, you can go to your county and work up an education plan, and then take that to your private school and see if the private schools do not have to abide by any of that. So it's up to you as to if you want to stay. Now, I will add on that.
Your money can change their opinion.
Yes. I will add on that, though, having an education plan, if you are in a private school, when you do hit 10th grade, for SAT testing, ACT testing. Those are two completely different companies. And I will tell you, from working with Morgan, right now we're in the mix of taking tests. And we're in the mix of a huge battle with College Board on getting accommodations. And one of the ways that we have been able to facilitate getting some of the accommodations that we're fighting for is we pulled out old IEPs and we've used them to document from 8th grade to 11th grade, we've done X, Y, and Z. If we don't do this, she's not gonna be able to do well on the test. And so that has been a tremendous help. Those two companies are two completely different companies when you go to start taking tests.
Okay. In Dallas, my daughter went to Notre Dame School of Dallas, and the Dallas ISD provided speech therapist as well as a PT therapist as well as OT.
Okay.
My daughter was given those services and had the same ARDS through the ISD.
Okay. So it sounds like it just depends on what district you're in. And you're right, different ways of advocating. So there's financial ways to advocate also, as you were saying. And we're saying, it's a lot of, even for me, I had to use IEPs to prove to ACT, SAT that I needed that extended time, but it was almost every time I took it. So it wasn't like they were like, oh yeah, we remember you last time you needed this. And I was like, no, again, we need to see that you need, but it helped me get a higher score. So it was
It's very important
to
do
and
that.
I learned anxiety
from the hard way this year working with them. It's having those education plans if you're in a private setting for test taking when you're doing those, it's extremely important.
And I was in public, so it didn't matter. Public was the same way. Their research, I was pull out your IEP and send it in with your application.
So you might want to err on the side of over-accommodating for your future. I mean, I think we had every accommodation possible. We took four different Saturdays for her, 4 hours every Saturday because of the speed thing. And just, I think I'm really not sure there's an accommodation that we didn't have.
And we're public too, and still having that, even with the school providing everything for those tests, it's not something that College Board, they could say, this is what's on your IEP, and still not approve it when it comes to test taking.
Yep.
And that's happened, and we've had to do an appeal and go through the motions of doing it. So whether it's private, public, it does not matter.
Right. All right, I'm going to move this along because I want to have time for question and answer before we go to ordinance. Shame you. Transition services, including classes a student will take, referred to as courses of study, to each other. So you're trying to, all of this needs to be in part of your thoughts or your transition plan as you're spelling it out from 16 out if you're going to wait that long. A statement that the child has been informed of his or her rights and that will transfer at the age of majority, most defined by state law, which my state is 18, I guess some are different. So that they know, hey, when you turn this age, it's gonna be your ball game. And that being said, you give them the right to make their own decisions unless you decide that maybe they may need power attorney or a guardian, okay? And those are touchy things we'll get on to later a little bit, just to bring them up as it may be a necessity for different people. All right. Let's see if the people who've applied to higher education agree with this. I want you to know, when you apply for college, you do not have to reveal your disability. People are like, what? How do I do that? Okay, if you're in a chair, if you use a walker, and you're walking into whatever to apply, that may be hard. Can't cloak yourself, I wish you could, same for job applications. I wish I could just cloak myself so maybe everybody sees me and not whatever's around me. So you don't have to, but if you choose to inform them of your disability, meaning I'm talking about accommodations for education. If you choose to say, hey, I need extra long test time, or I need a scribe to write, my essays, or, now it's computers, but still, you may need somebody to type them for you, those types of things. It's good to have your IEP. We kind of talked about how important IEPs are. It's good to have documentation backing you up, okay? Because I have actually recently helped a patient of Ashburn Run Strip who called me in a panic because her school said, I'm sorry, you cannot be in this chemistry class, it's part of your pre-med track, because you might trip and fall and spill the very combustible thing and blow up the entire lab. And I said, wait, where are you going to school? And she said, some obscure town in upstate New York. And I said, okay, but I don't care. They're required to accommodate you. And well, they have my accommodations. They've been fine. I'm in my third semester. Well, anyway, long story short, we got on the phone and we fixed it. Because I said, you know what? You can either do this the easy, we said, you can do this the easy way or the hard way. We can take this legally to a court and you can be shown that you're not following through on what you are federally mandated and have been shown she needs. And you are telling her to switch her major based on a disability. That is out and out discrimination. It is based on your perception of her disability. You have no idea what she can do or can't do. And they cleared it up. They paid for the aid to come in, which she was shocked. I was like, well, they weren't just going to approve the aid and not pay them. But you know, she was just glad to have the aid. She didn't care if she got paid or not, but I did. I said, you know what, I don't care if she works 40 hours a week. If that's what the student needs, sorry, find it somewhere, you know. But it's that thing, like, but I got told the same thing. And called Dr. Dan in a mess of tears because I was like, these people know better. Well, no, they don't. And now I know that, and I can pass that wisdom on to somebody else. So, schedule meetings with disability services when you visit. We're going to have some talk about that a little later. I do want to re-emphasize that. Ask, oh, this is Claire's correct idea. I didn't even think about this back in the day. So ask for visits with other students with disabilities. Now, like, why is that very important?
So when we visited the school that I actually decided to go to, this was one of our last college visits, and we've had so many horrible experiences, you know, just with tour guides leaving my brothers out or thinking I'm the only one there for a visit. And we just were like, you know what, we need to really know, what is this school? And so we met this girl who's in a power wheelchair like my brother and has CP, and it was the best thing we could have done. She gave us so many tips for Benjamin and what going to college looks like. As well as just saying, like, this is the school. Yes, I'm going to tell you that we are accepting. You don't have to just hear it from Disability Services. So I think that's the best thing you can do, honestly. It really is.
All right. Any other questions? Okay. Mini transition. So we don't all transition once, even though we all hear that word, so much transitions. We actually do a bunch of mini transitions that can help your child when you come here. Okay, so you don't have to wait until you graduate high school to start transitioning successfully. In other words, you get practice in this, okay? Give you the ability to get ready for your bigger future transitions, I think. An example where came up with a good one when we were talking about this, which was
therapy goal. So when we were in high school, you know, my brother's occupational therapist are still working on him, shoe tying and teeth brushing. And finally, Benjamin was like, all right, come on. Like, my mom is here. She can help me with brushing my teeth. Let's do some real goals. And so she started helping with Mason with some visual acuity stuff for driving. And so I think that's another pretty great way to help your teenager self-advocate.
And that also makes them feel developing something like their peers. How many times have, like, everybody's like, oh, we're gonna go for that, going there, going for that. And you're sitting, I was the kid sitting over there going, I get to go to study, oh, cool. Like, because they didn't think I could drive. Like, what was that? And I was like, oh, you know, but that's just how it was. You didn't know any question. My mom didn't want me to drive. She's like, oh my God, this kid behind the wheel of the car, are you kidding me? And then Leslie brought up a good point that you remember saying, medicine,
definitely.
Oh,
that
you
yeah.
Never really thought about
those
types of things.
When she started going to school, we had like 5 or 6 new aides. We never had an aide in high school. I mean, like at home, like any help at home. So sometimes her college assistants, you know, I'm like, hey, I don't like this. We might try this at home a little bit. And so, but I realized she didn't even know what medication she took. I popped it in her mouth for 20 years and she couldn't tell you. She might know the name of the medicine, but she couldn't tell you the dosage. And so just
you know, just that's something that's just one of those many transitions to keep in mind. And yeah, even though I was thinking I was doing a pretty good job of teaching her independence, there's still just those little things that you just take for granted and realize it whenever they start school.
Yeah. Practice explores possibilities, okay, in little ways. So you don't have to go for the whole enchilada and everybody's like, oh, I turned my laundry key. I thought it was on the laundry dryer. It was in the basement. I just thought it magically appeared for you. So, yeah, I'm going on to the next slide. All right, this is not going to work for the next slide. Healthcare. You are the expert on your own needs, and I'm speaking to the young adults and families, okay? Know your needs and be prepared to work with providers because you are clueless about CP. And there's more of them out there than there are Dr. Fields, okay? So we all know that. Teach and know as much media service, as much of their medical education as possible. All right. And I mean, even if you have had various things going on, I have a worse memory as I get older, I've heard that's a thing. But you need to be able to have maybe in an iPad, in the phone, okay? What's your list of medications? You know, not just the number, if something happens, call mom. That's great, we want to do that, all that. But like, what do they need to know? Does your child have a seizure disorder? Okay? And if the seizure happens now with friends, that could happen. Okay? What do they do? Are you a better work bracelet that looks cool? Okay? Got to look cool, but that's where it's okay. Kind of like braces. All right. Okay. Practice. Role play things. It may seem stupid. Morgan may be like, that's another thing I will roll my eyes at. And that's fine. But practice anyway. Okay? Because the more you practice, the more you're not going to be nervous, and the better your confidence will be in those different situations. So practice leaving them in, or helping them write down questions for the doctor. Or telling the doctor, no, you know nothing about what makes my spasm worse. I don't, weird things people said to me that I can share later. Holland set up their own, this whole slide was at the young adults, but Holland set up your own appointments. Oh, what? Oh, you use the phone for everything else. Holland tried to set up an appointment. You know what I mean? You can order the pizza. And I'm speaking to those that may have trouble with communication. Holland practice that because that can be scary when your voice is hard to hear. But if you want to be on your own, you gotta have a way, a plan. Even if it means when my aides come over, they're gonna help me make this call so that I'm there if somebody can't understand me. They're like, what on the speakerphone? I can't hear you. Click. No, we don't want that experience. But they can at least help me. I'll try first. If they don't understand me, they will reinforce what I said, not doing it for them. Completely helping. Okay. All right. Alright, points to ponder. These can be sensitive issues, but I'm just bringing them up because I like to stir the pot and then move on. Alright. health insurance options. Once you're an adult and it's over the age of covered, alright? If they want a job, you need to think about, are they gonna apply for Medicaid? Well, if they wanna work, then that's fine. Then is that job going to have insurance? Like things that my parents never told me about. Copays. Like you have to pay that money at the desk. And I was like, what? Why is that a thing? Like, but I was a student health arguing with the lady. Like, no. And I pay tuition. She's like, but I'm not COVID. Whatever. So, everyone should plan for the future. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. None of us. No adult in this room, kid with CP, person with CP. Nobody knows. You should start thinking about future. What if something happens to the caregiver, provider, all of a sudden, tragically, I'm sorry, it sounds like a bummer, but we're going to talk about it. You need to have maybe a special needs trust. Okay, put some money away because it can help them when they move out on their own. Again, I said that. Or a will that says, hey, so-and-so is going to need help when they get older because they do have some memory processing issues, so they're going to need help. I want so-and-so to be the kind of overseer or the one who steps in, okay? not takes over their independence, but understands what our plans are now, and I want to continue that. And not just come in and be the boom, okay, well, now that whoever is not around, mom or dad or grandma, grandma, whoever, I'm gonna come over and I'm gonna do all your stuff for you, and you just say one sheet. Nope. Somebody's gotta be on the same page with you. If a young person needs formal decision-making assistance, okay, understand the difference between guardianship and power of attorney, okay? This can vary state by state as well, so I can't speak to every state. What I do know, basically, is that power of attorney can be revoked at any time by anyone. You can say, nope, I want Bob to be my power of attorney. Remember Bob? Met him on the bus stop, you seem friendly, and there you go, all right? Guardianship seems like a better option for a lot of parents, which are like, well, so we can take, they can make the decisions, and there won't be any questions of, can Bob make the decision or whatever. Okay, but in a lot of places, you strip them of rights, of getting married, of voting, of things that they could do. Okay, now, in Missouri, we have limited guardianship, which basically says, this person needs to help them with da-da-da-da decisions, but I want them to retain the right to marry, to vote, to do. And people are like, oh, we're talking about marriage now? No, we're not really gonna for next year, everybody. All right, moving on. All right, now we're gonna run through this whole thing. Higher education isn't the only option. You need post-secondary education. I need to get higher. You all have to do that, sorry. For some, the best choice may be going to work or a day program. Okay, I understand that those are different issues. College isn't for any of us even in this room all the time. All right. Independence doesn't look like simply making your own choices, such as what to have for dinner. So if you have a more involved young adult, because they're still a young adult, they're not a child, okay? You ask them what they want for dinner. Have them give them choices for outfits. Don't just put it on them. Give them whatever autonomy they can have. Okay?
Before early in your senior year, start taking Okay. All right, move down. Up. I defer to...
These were just a few little things that we found. SnapHive is an app that, like last week, we live out of our, we're not in town, so we needed a library card. So they handed her a form to fill out, and if I hadn't been there, then she'd been, you know, having a problem. So this takes a picture of the form, and you can type in the answers for someone who can't physically write. And we use a doorbell at night. I don't know. It's hard for her to use her phone at night if she needs some help during the night. Her covers are messed up or whatever it is. And then I got so sick of her joystick coming off, that ball that drove me and crazy. And so we found a really simple solution. Just a little ball from a Hobby Lobby store and inset screw and cover it with balloon. Never comes off. So this is my silly little tricks.
Accepted. I felt strongly I wanted to attend our local Christian university, like my siblings, but wanted to at least check out another school. It took about 10 minutes into the visit for me to realize they had very little experience with someone who had a physical disability. Definitely a lack of proper research on our part. I got in the car and told Mom, at least I know where I don't want to go. What you don't want is almost as important as understanding what you do want. When we pulled into our second and final college visit, there was an accessible parking spot marked off with my name on it. My admissions counselor said she had already walked the tour and made sure it was all accessible. This was the beginning of how the rest of the day progressed, which led to feeling very welcome and accepted.
Beautiful. All right, I'm going to hurry up and talk even faster than I've been talking because we're down to like 30 seconds. All right, so thank you, Mackenzie. That was worth waiting for. And never get nervous, just good time. And it'll be worth it. It'll be worth it, and it was. All right. So that she kind of covered all those points. There we go. See, everybody read that? She, you heard her. That was better than my voice. All right. Okay, so we're going to get over in college or on the campus, wherever, going to a work permit, use transportation, other options, if you have them. I know small towns may not, but all buses should be accessible. There should be like a call to ride, that's what we call it in our hometown. Where maybe when you are away from home, you don't want Mom taking you to everything, like the movies, or why don't you say Mom or Dad, grandma, whoever. You don't know, kid. So just explore other things so that they can be even more independent as, you know, stuff. Okay, 4, advocate for yourself in all areas. We've been belaboring this point, but it's very important. That may be simply saying that you're interested in an activity. Now, this is harder to do as you're newer in a place, right? Because you're like, okay, you may be the only one there with a disability, or you may not be, so maybe hard. But saying to people, hey, I'd really like to go to that movie. Or whatever. And then, you know, it's kind of first thing might look at you like, what? And then you say, well, we can go, I can get in the car to, you know, fill in those blanks. That's another good thing to role play, okay? Because that can be very scary.
And Kelly?
Yes.
And I would just like to add, too, that friends are usually way more willing to help than you might think.
Yes,
and I, you know, I told you I went to the school and we met with the girls CP and we became really close. And she had a plan where she would, at the beginning of the year, ask a group of her friends to come pick one night a week to stay with her because she didn't have overnight nursing. And I mean, people were like fighting over the slot. So seriously, friends are huge, huge support and they love to help.
Also, that being said, if you have an OT or PT program at your school, those people are required to have hours. They are awesome because they'll work for cheap if you have to pay them.
Okay. Those students, I should say, not those people.
Okay. Take college or job training at your own pace, right? I mean, who says 4 years is the right pace for you? In fact, I mean, I got a friend that was on the tenure plate, but he got a degree. Who cares? By the way, you also have a CD if I don't believe that. Alright, moving on. Alright, tip number two. Parents, let your kids make mistakes. Let it go. Alright, teachable moments often make a bigger impact than you just fixing it, okay? And finally, number one. Be confident in you and what you can do. That's more for the, you know, what they, you, them can do, okay? All right, and I think that's it. Questions, we don't have time. See you later. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.